do if they break you? If you continue to fight, what will you become?
Well, what is happening, my stardusts of the internet? It is D-Wizzle here. Thank you, as always, for tuning back to the channel. And before we go any further, I just have a message for Lucasfilm and Star Wars, because I heard a rumor going around, and I hope this is not true whatsoever, and it's kind of made me mad. She will not. I repeat, Brie Larson will not be Ahsoka Tano in a live-action Star Wars film. Do you hear me? Do not do that. No.
Wait, what?
Yeah, that was a rumor going around. Brie Larson wants to be Ahsoka Tano in a live-action Star Wars film. You gotta watch Rebels and Clone Wars, but she's
what?
Yes. She was Anakin's Padawan in Clone Wars.
Yes, I've heard of her.
Yes. I know, it's horrible, ain't it? So, Ahsoka Tano deserves much better than Brie Larson, so please, do not cast her in a Star Wars film, or I will go to your building and burn it down to the ground. Okay? Thank you. I'm kidding, guys. This is entertainment. I'm just over-exaggerating, but that will make me really mad. Anyway, this is episode 19 of the D-Wizzle podcast, and we are continuing in our journey in a galaxy far, far away. We are talking about all the live-action, theatrically released Star Wars films leading up to Star Wars Episode 9, The Rise of Skywalker, being released this December. We talked about all the prequel films, The Phantom Menace, Attack of the Clones, and Revenge of the Sith. And we talked about Solo, the Star Wars story. If you guys haven't watched those, I'll leave links in the description below so you guys can watch them. But today, we're going to be talking about the first anthology film of Star Wars, Rogue One, A Star Wars Story. Joining with me today, I have Captain Eagle.
Hey there.
We have Crimson Amazon.
Hey.
We have Baby Amazon in the background bouncing. And we have fellow YouTuber, Ruby Groovy.
Ladies and gentlemen, I am ready to go.
Awesome. So,
I don't know if you can hear the microphone, but that's a bag of chips.
Yes, that's a lot of... Worst
that's my ASMR work.
Worst ASMR ever.
Okay, how's this for a change?
What was that?
That was my pop.
That was your pop? Oh, I was like, what is that? Trust in me. Anyway.
That's funny. You got it.
So, I know it's been a while since you've heard from us. I'm sure some of you were like, are they still reviewing Star Wars movies? Where are they at, man? It's like, yeah, I'm sorry, we're really late. A lot has happened since our last podcast, actually. Big news! Crimson Amazon and Captain Eagle got married!
Yeah!
So, I was the best man at their wedding, so we've been dealing with a bunch of wedding stuff.
Yeah. Baby Amazon concurs.
Got back from our honeymoon last week.
Yep. So I've been dealing with a lot of that stuff, and then on my end, I've been trying to figure out some stuff with my channel. There's going to be some big changes to my channel, so I've been trying to work some stuff out. I'm going to make a video about the changes, but yeah, there's going to be some stuff different about the channel. So tune in when I make a video about that eventually. So I've just been dealing with a bunch of stuff, but I'm going to try and get back on course. And also, we have other podcasts that we want to do on the Marvel and DC side that we're trying to get to. So we're going to try and get back to it. So yeah, let's talk about Rogue One. So once again, we're going in chronological order. So once again, gonna be weird talking about these movies out of sync for when they were theatrically released. So let's do it. All right. So we're well into Disney owning Star Wars at this period of time when it was about to come out. We saw The Force Awakens. We'll talk about it more in the coming months. But I loved The Force Awakens. I thought it was a great addition to the Star Wars mythos, and also alleviated my doubts of it, you know, what Disney was going to plan to do with Star Wars, because I was kind of worried about what Disney was going to do with the property. But, you know, The Force Awakens showed me, okay, yeah, they know what they're doing. Like, they actually care about this property. So I'm looking forward to seeing what else they will do. So when Disney announced that they were doing more Star Wars films, not only were they going to continue on with the main saga films, but they were going to do anthologies, spin-offs of the universe that don't exactly have to coincide with the main plots of the numerical films. And I thought that was an interesting idea, actually. I think that was a good idea, because for me personally, with the saga films from the prequels and the original trilogy, I felt like there was more things that they could explore, and then there's certain things that they did in the original films and the prequels that I wish they elaborated on when it comes to character development and story and worlds and stuff like that. So I thought, okay, that's a good idea, a good opportunity for them to, you know, take these anthology films and expand on stuff that we want to know more about. So when I first heard about, you know, what their first anthology film is going to be, it's going to be called Rogue One, and I was like, okay, that's a solid title. I like that. And then I hear what the movie's going to be about. The movie that was going to be about some rebels getting the plans to the Death Star. And I was like, okay. I mean, not exactly what I am dying to see or know about, really. But we'll see how it goes, I guess. So they got the director they got for this movie is Gareth Edwards. For those of you who don't know who that is, he directed the 2014 Godzilla. And I was really excited about that because I really enjoyed the 2014 Godzilla. I know some people have negative thoughts about it, but I thought it was a good movie. And regardless of how you feel about the characters and the story, his sense of scope and cinematography is breathtaking. So at the very least, I think he will add his unique style to the movie. That'll be very interesting to see. So when it came to the marketing and the trailers, I remember the first trailer they released, and I was lukewarm about it. It didn't look bad. It wasn't as bad as the Solo marketing, but it was like, I don't know, I wasn't blown away, really. I was just like, okay. And then we had, I forget, who is the main actress for this movie?
Felicity Jones.
I haven't really seen her in anything that she was in, though I heard she's really good in movies like The Theory of Everything and stuff like that. So
she was really good in that,
yeah.
Yeah, me
either. Yeah. So in this trailer, I didn't like her, honestly. She seemed kind of awkward, really, and really stoic, and gave her that horrible line. This is a rebellion, right? I rebel. Oh my god. What? And then they had Forrest Whitaker in here, and I was like, oh, you got Forrest Whitaker in a Star Wars movie? Oh, that's interesting. And then they had, I'm sorry, I'm horrible, I don't remember everyone's name. Who's the actor who played Credic?
Ben Mendelsohn.
Okay, so this is the first movie that I would see him in, so.
Other than Dark Knight Rises.
But he was in Dark Knight. Yeah, that's right. Yeah. I forgot. Yeah. He was the person that got choked out by Bane.
Yeah.
That helped my company absorb Wayne.
That guy. So, yeah, he was in it. I was like, okay, that's cool. And then there were some shots of the Stormtroopers with new uniforms that we haven't seen in the movies. I'm like, oh, that's really slick. And there were some cool visual shots and stuff like that. But outside of that, I was like, and then they had that weird, like, horn going on in the background, like,
the Empire horn.
Yeah, I'm like,
the Death Star horn, yeah.
Yeah, I was like, was that an editing mistake? What is this? It was, like, kind of jarring. It didn't flow well with the trailer, so I was taken back a little bit. I'm like, okay. Okay, and then the second trailer came out, and it was much better. Had more action set pieces. I got a little bit more of a feel. Not that much, but I was like, I didn't feel as worried about Felicity Jones' character as much. It like felt a little bit more natural in this trailer. And then we got more scenes of Forrest Whitaker and stuff like that. And then that one shot that everyone was freaking out about. Darth Vader was going to be in this movie, and everyone lost their mind. And I was like,
I broke my finger from it.
Wait, what?
I broke my finger when I saw it. I literally smacked my counter when I saw Darth Vader. I was like, shit, ow.
Isn't that after they did all the reshoots that trailer came out?
We'll get to that,
actually.
I think
that was before, actually. That might have been after, actually. I don't know.
Yeah.
I can't remember.
Yeah, I was going to get to that, But yeah, everyone was freaking out about Darth Vader in this movie, and I was sitting here being like, isn't it obvious, guys? I mean, if this is about them getting the Death Star plans, Darth Vader has to be in this movie. I would have been really disappointed if he wasn't. Like, he's an integral part of the Death Star being created and stuff like that. So, yeah, of course he's going to be in this movie. So I wasn't really, like, freaking out, but I'll admit it was really nice to see Darth Vader again because we haven't seen him in, like, 11 years. So it was really nice to see him again. So I definitely felt more optimistic about this movie after the second film. I mean, the second trailer. I'm sorry. After the second trailer and the TV spots and stuff like that. So I was in it pretty optimistic. Like I said, The Force Awakens really surprised me. So I was thinking, okay, they're probably going to surprise me with this film. So remember, I saw it opening night, and
yeah, we all saw it together on like the Thursday. Was it the Thursday night?
Yeah. I think it is. Yeah. Okay, yeah. So we all saw it opening night. I forgot that actually.
Yeah, I was looking forward to the movie too. I wasn't sure what to expect, but I was excited for like a new movie that was set in the original trilogy.
Yeah.
Since we hadn't had that yet,
right?
So it'd be cool to see all the original costumes. And mm-hmm. sets, you know, that we'd be familiar with from.
Yeah, and seeing like some stuff like modified for today, like they have the technology to make things like look more sleek and stuff like that. So I was definitely excited. I was pumped. I was ready for this film. And walking out, the first time I saw it, I just thought it was good. Yeah, I just thought it was good. It didn't blow me away. I didn't regret watching the movie, but I enjoyed it, but I was like, I guess I was kind of let down with certain stuff. And then the more I watched it like 3-4 more times in the theater, and then I got it on Blu-ray, I watched it a few more times. Because, you know, everyone was raving about this film, like saying it's one of the best Star Wars films ever made. So I'm like, okay, let me watch it again. Let me watch it a few more times. Let me just see if I can get what people are saying. And the more I watched it, the more I started seeing problems and just stuff that I couldn't overlook. So I watched it recently, a couple days ago, as of this recording, just to see how I feel about it and like analyzing and taking notes. And my thoughts of Rogue One is, it's okay. I mean, it's not awful. It's a film in the Star Wars universe. there's some really good moments in this movie. There's some stuff that I really enjoyed about it, and there's some stuff that they Easter eggs and like stuff they add to the lore that I appreciated, but overall, I didn't feel this was very memorable, or I didn't feel like this was as memorable as the stuff in the original trilogy, or even The Force Awakens, honestly. I will say it's better, I think it's a better made film than the prequels. that's what I got for you, but, you know, I just thought it was meh. But yeah, that's how I feel about it. Crimson, what did you think about Rogue One, A Star Wars Story?
I really like it. I really like it because, you know, this franchise is called Star Wars, okay?
Yeah.
And while we've had, like, battles and stuff, they haven't really focused on the other aspects of war. Like, we've never seen labor camps, but like Evan, like Captain Eagle said last night when we were watching it, you would think that they would have labor camps to get all their shit done. Mm-hmm. You would think that they would, but they've never shown that. They've never really shown that before. Mm-hmm. And I just like that they showed the darker side of it, like people getting like beaten up and like, mm-hmm. you know, I just like that it was darker, and I like that it focused more on the war rather than like cushy story. I guess that's how I would describe
cushy
it.
Cushy story.
Cushy story.
Okay. All right. Captain Eagle, what did you think about Rogue One?
I absolutely love this movie. I was blown away right from the start when we saw it. I knew it was special, it was unique, and it was powerful as well.
It is powerful.
Even though, you know, it is different from the other Star Wars movies that are episodic, but in a lot of the ways it's also very true to Star Wars at the same time. Even more Star Wars-y than a lot of the episodic Star Wars movies, in that it does feel like an actual war is going on. You get a lot of context to the beginnings of the original trilogy, and it just really expands on that and deepens the lore and the world of the original trilogy of Star Wars, just by showing you more, showing you, I guess, the background and sort of like, I guess, the inner workings of what's going on, instead of just focusing on the Jedi characters. You know, you just feel like you get the full picture of Episode 4 by watching this first. Okay. So I absolutely love that they did that. You know, this is like another like lost episode in the original trilogy, and it's just fucking amazing for that.
Okay, Ruby. Let us have it. What did you think about Rogue One, the Star Wars story?
Okay. So I saw this like a few hours ago, the first time seeing it since I saw it in the theaters, because I only got like a notification last night that today we were going to be doing the podcast. So I was like, oh shit, when am I going to have time to see this? I'll just see it when I get home from work. So I saw it a couple hours ago. And it's hard to put in words. First of all, I do not care about any of the people that were introduced in this film. Not a goddamn character. I did not care about the Erso family. I thought that storyline was bland. I didn't care about Cassian. I remembered the names this time. Like, when I saw it in the theaters for the first time, I only knew, like, three names. And then seeing it today, I know, like, a lot more characters' names because I actually, like, looked up the names. But, I didn't care about the Erso family. I hated Cassian. I didn't like, Krennic, sadly, because I thought that he was going to be cool, but Ben Mendelsohn was being too much Ben Mendelsohn. And I just feel, again, it's hard to put in words, because I said this in the previous podcast, and I'll say it again. While I think the anthology films are a unique idea, the way that it's presented to me, I don't like it. If they were presented as Netflix films,
or movies on the Disney streaming service.
What? Oh, yeah.
Disney streaming service.
Disney streaming service.
Yeah.
That would make more sense, but to have them as theatrically released films, they feel a little bit outshadowed, especially when a lot of other people say that, you know, these films are, like, a lot better than, you know, the prequels or The Last Jedi or whatever other Star Wars film there is. Like, people kept saying that this film was, like, better than Empire. Like, people actually said that Rogue One was better than Empire. And when I look at it at that sense, it makes me not like the movie more. Because I can't compare that. You can't compare this film with the original trilogy, really. So, it makes me hate Rogue One more if I focus on the fan base, but regardless of that, I still thought it was just a disappointment.
Okay. Alright, well, you know how I like to do it on my podcast. I like to stick with the positives first before we get into issues that I'm sure we're going to be fighting each other about. But, Dang, I thought Last Jedi was going to be divisive. This is divisive, too. One person loves it. One person thinks it's okay. One person thinks it's horrible. One person likes it. Oh, my gosh.
Oh, don't worry. This is just the pre-show leading into Last Jedi.
Oh, yeah. This is
just the pre-show.
All right. Well, let's get it on in. So I like to start with the one thing that I thought was awesome, hands down, two thumbs up, amazing in this film. The visuals in this movie, top level tier. The effects in this movie are amazing.
They are the best in the entire Star Wars saga.
Yes, it is.
Like, there's no film that has better effects than Rogue One. It's number one for me for that.
Seriously, there's only two things, which I'll talk about later. There's like two things that I was like, that I didn't think was that strong, but overall, the visuals in this movie are breathtaking. Like I said, when Gareth Edwards was brought in to make this movie, I knew this movie was going to look amazing, and it's like he got a good sense of what Star Wars is supposed to look like, at least original trilogy sense. Like, things look grimy, dirty, lived in. All the aliens and costume designs, they all looked real. They all looked a part of this world. But on top of the costumes and stuff, just like the scope of all the planets and the lands and environments, it just looks so massive and huge. Like, you're actually there.
And there's a lot of variety, too.
Yeah. Definitely. And even with, like, he even is creative with the shots with the ships going past. There's that awesome shot in the trailer that, with the giant Star Destroyer, like, moving forward, and there's, like, this huge shadow, and the shadow slowly reveals the Death Star behind it.
Yeah.
That was
in the film, too.
There were so many parts in this movie where my jaw drops to the floor with how gorgeous this film is. It was just amazing. Like I said, there's a couple things towards the end, which I'll talk about. But like the most part, there was not one thing in this movie that took me out visual-wise. What's her name again? The actress, Felicity Jones.
Yeah, Felicity Jones.
I liked Jen. I thought she was good. I didn't love her, but she definitely surprised me because I thought she wasn't going to be that great going in, but I thought she was a pretty decent character, and there was some stuff with her family and her dad, played by Mads Mikkelsen. I thought there was some stuff, some delivery that she's done that was pretty compelling. And then K2SO. Oh my god, let's talk about this droid. I think, he's probably my favorite droid in the entire saga.
One of the best ones.
Like, I loved BB-8 in The Force Awakens, but K2SO, like, oh my god, he was the whole package for me. Not only does, like, he's funny and he's witty, but also he kicks ass. Like, when his first introduction in the movie is him chokeslamming Jin to the floor, saying, "Congratulations, you're being rescued. Please don't resist." I'm like, oh, that was badass. I loved it. Yeah, K2SO was great, and he played an integral part of the, you know, of the overall mission. Like, he didn't just feel like a side character like C-3PO and R2-D2 to an extent. Like, he actually felt just as important as everyone else. He actually felt like an actual person. And even, I complained about this about L337 and Solo, but when K2SO was being witty, it didn't feel mean-spirited at all. Like, he was likable. Like, his humor didn't go too far to the point where I'm like, okay, really, you didn't really need to say that or anything like that. It's like, his humor was put in the right places. Mm-hmm. So, definitely like that. My favorite character in the movie, and I feel bad because I don't remember his name, Donnie-Yen.
Yeah, it's hard to pronounce his character's name.
Yeah.
I don't know how to pronounce it, but that's Crimson's favorite character as well.
Yeah, Donnie-Yen I thought was...
He was so
really interesting. I wish there was more of him. I wish we knew more about him, but I thought he was the most interesting of everyone. Not just because, you know, he's, like, the only tie to, like, the Force and the Jedi. Like, that. Outside of that, he's just really interesting, you know, because he's blind, and it's like, I'm a sucker for blind characters, like, because the blind characters always end up being the most wisest characters in movies and TV shows, and, like, Donnie Yen's no exception to that. He is very cool, and also he has some really cool action sequences here and there,
and to be able to see, like, an actual Force user that isn't a Jedi.
Yeah, that isn't a Jedi.
You know, that's part of what I was talking about with the really expanding the universe of Star Wars and seeing what else can be done with the Force. I just thought that was so great.
Mm-hmm. And of course, I love his one line in the movie. I am one with the Force. The Force is with me. I am one with the Force. The Force is with me. I loved it every time he said it. And yeah, his friend was okay.
Blaze.
Yeah, Blaze, the guy with the blaster. He was all right. He was a nice companion with him. Like I said, I wish there was even more with him because I didn't get that much with him. But they were okay. Okay, Forrest Whitaker as Saw Gerrera. Okay, he's in my positives and negatives.
Apparently, he's a character on Clone Wars and Rebels as well.
Yes, he is. Yeah. So what I will say about him in this, I'll talk about more about him in my negatives, but I will say, in this movie, Forrest Whitaker was an inspired choice. I think he was perfect casting for Saw Gerrera. And there was some good moments with him and Jin. But really, my love for him is more with, like I said, the Clone Wars and Rebels. So it's more like I'm glad that he's in a live action film, and I'm glad that he's being portrayed pretty well by Forrest Whitaker. And that's the extent of my positives with him. I'll get to him with the negatives. Director critic. Once again, I know we differ about this, Ruby, but it's like he's just one of those actors where he's over the top in every movie and he plays the same character, but he's so over the top and charismatic that you enjoy watching him. Like, he's not boring to watch.
Deliciously
over the top. Yeah. So I did enjoy watching him for the most part. There was a couple of spots where I was like, okay, this is a little too much. But
it goes with his character, though, because he is the leader, the one who is running the Death Star. You know, and it's just newly constructed. It's the most powerful weapon ever built. You know he's going to have an ego. So, he's an Imperial, whatever.
Yeah.
It fit his character.
Mm-hmm.
So it didn't take me out. I thought it was really cool.
Okay. I liked some of the designs of the Stormtroopers. There's some, like uniforms that they're wearing that we didn't see in the original trilogy that I thought was cool. Like, the black Stormtroopers, they were wearing all black, and they were walking with Krennic. I thought they looked awesome. And I liked the droids that are, like, K2SO. That was a really cool. Let's see, what else? I'll say the last 30 to 45 minutes is awesome. Like, the whole space battle towards the end I thought was really good. It rivals the space battle in Return of the Jedi for me, almost there for me. Just thought that was, like, really good. Darth Vader, once again, in my positives and negatives, it was great to see him, and I argue that he has one of his best moments in this movie.
These are some of the best Darth Vader moments in the entire series.
Yes, for sure. And it was nice to hear James Earl Jones voice him again, so that was nice. And there was the stuff that they added for A New Hope, like that stupid thing that people were talking about. Why does the Death Star have a huge gaping weakness that anybody could see? That's very convenient. Well, they gave an explanation for that, because Jin's father, played by Mads Mikkelsen, created the Death Star and was against the Empire the entire time and created that weakness for the Rebellion to to use. So, okay, that's... I like that they...
I love that monologue that he gets where he explains himself and, like, mm-hmm. his motives and why he did what he did. Right. It's just so fucking genius that you would, like, change what was sort of viewed as a plot hole and actually have it be, like, a plot point mm-hmm. in the anthology movie to really complement episode 4 mm-hmm. and have there be a reason why it's like that. It just makes both movies better mm-hmm. for it. So I absolutely love that. It's one of my favorite things about this movie is that they give context to the Death Star weakness.
Mm-hmm. Definitely. There was some returning characters from the prequels and the original trilogy that I really liked. Bail Organa from episode 2 and 3 came back, and he's an important part of the rebellion stuff. I freaked out when I saw him come on screen. I was like, oh yes, he's back! Yes! Take that, haters of the prequels. They're like, it's not going to acknowledge the prequels that much because they were stupid. Well, guess mm-hmm. what? This movie acknowledges the prequels, and also the Force Awakens acknowledged the prequels, so I'm glad that they brought characters back from the previous movies.
And that lady as well on the Rebels.
Yeah, Mon Mothma.
Yeah,
I was really happy to see her too. She looked a lot like the original character in Return of the Jedi, like exactly like a younger version of her. Like, so perfect casting with that. It almost felt like I was seeing a ghost. I'm like, is that the same? What is
speaking of ghosts?
Okay,
Grand Moff Tarkin.
Okay, so it's positives and negatives also. So for its time, I know this is the first time that they tried reanimating someone who passed away. For the most part, it looked fine. Like it was rendered enough that I believed 85% he was there.
I'd give it a little more than that. I thought it was almost fucking flawless. Crimson actually forgot that that was CGI, and I had to tell her that the actor died, and that was CGI. She was like, no fucking way. Mm-hmm. And my mind was just blown. I think I just gasped in the theater when I saw him. It was just so fucking perfect.
Mm-hmm. So
I love that CGI.
And Leia, though... We'll talk about it more, okay, so, yeah, like I said, rendering aside, I thought it was pretty creative how they were able to put them back into the story. I mean, Tarkin obviously is an important part of the Death Star as well, so they figured out a way to bring him back, and then obviously Leia is going to be important to the story. I actually didn't think Leia was going to be in this movie, so it was a surprise to see her at the end. And this was right fresh after Carrie Fisher died.
Well, at the time that we saw it, she hadn't died yet.
Oh, right.
She died right after.
After that, so that was like a huge like, oh, dang.
So it wasn't really anything to us other than oh, Leia.
Yeah, when that we was first saw it. Like and there was those muggers from A New Hope that was like, you better watch yourself. Yeah, there was that thing in the whatever that thing was. They made an appearance. I was that was a good
cameo.
That was nice. And is that it? Is that all my positives? I think so. I Ruby, I know you have to like hold your breath on this. Is there anything in here that you liked?
How important this is for me to hold all of this in, just to let you know.
Yes. But is there anything here that you're like, all right, that was all right?
Yeah.
Okay, I'll agree with you on Darth Vader. The Darth Vader sequences, some of them might be some of his best moments in all of Star Wars. That's a given. The third act space battle, also a given, was pretty damn cool. For me, it actually comes to third next to beated by A New Hope and Return of the Jedi. A New Hope because it's just more of a nostalgic feeling for me.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I grew up with A New Hope more than Rogue One, so I kind of have to give A New Hope a more of an edge mm-hmm. there. And then Return of the Jedi was just Return of the Jedi.
Return of the Jedi, yes.
But, what else do I have? Forrest Whitaker actually, yes, was a very wise choice to have in this movie. I was very happy to see him, and I actually kind of liked him a little bit more than what what you think, Dwayne, in this film. And hearing, again, James Earl Jones as Darth Vader, yes, was cool and got me chills. Dwayne, your favorite character, Donnie Yen, the actor who played him, his character,
yeah.
The things that he can do were cool.
Hmm.
The things that he can do were cool, and same with his partner.
Mm-hmm.
Like with all of their combat and whatnot, but that honestly, that's really all I have.
All right, then let's get into negatives because there's a lot.
Nothing about the visuals, nothing about characters. I'll get to that. My negatives.
Yeah, let's just get into negatives now because that's going to be the main bulk of our thing. Okay, so. Where do I start with this?
I don't have a lot of negatives.
I know you don't. So this is how the portion.
Well, this segment pretty much belongs to me and Dwayne then.
Yeah. And then Crimson and Captain be like, actually no, that was amazing. What are you talking about?
Yeah.
All right, so here we go. Where do I start with this? There is some pacing issues in this movie. The first half of this film drags so bad.
What do you mean it drags? It's going super fast.
No,
it's
it like is not.
Boom, 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 going from environment to environment. It's like going. It's like you're jumping around.
Get to the next scene, they were so slow.
No, like yes, they're going from one planet to the next, but it just felt disjointed to me because. Yes, they were going from each planet to planet, but it didn't feel like the story started until halfway through the movie. Probably till Darth Vader comes. The plot doesn't... Actually, no, I'm gonna give more credit to that. And when Mads Mikkelsen has that hologram thing, that's when the plot started for me. Up until that point, yeah, they were just going from one planet to the next, and I'm just like, what's happening? What's going on?
They're trying to introduce characters and set the scene, because this is your first original trilogy movie. Other than Solo, fuck Solo.
No, oh my gosh. I still like Solo, for those to let you know, I still like it.
Actually,
but,
yeah, screw Solo a little bit.
You know what? y'all can go to hell. Anyway.
One actor, Han Solo.
Oh, well, better than 90% of these characters in this movie. I swear to God. Here's something y'all going to hate. You're going to hate. Grimps is going to hate. And people in the comments are going to be like, what are you talking about? You're stupid. What you call the porn version of Solo was more interesting than Jyn Erso.
Actually, yes.
Like, didn't think that would be a thing, but like, seriously, like, regardless of how
new Han Solo is actually better than Jyn Erso. I'm not going to disagree with that.
Like, seriously, regardless of how you feel about the movie overall, the movie and the Solo took more time to develop young Solo as a person. Like, yes, there's some choices that may not feel very consistent with Harrison Ford, but you got him as a character, as a person. And it's like, Jyn, it's like, okay, yeah, there was like that tragedy that happened with the parents, and that's really it. I don't really get to know her that much as a person outside of, oh yeah, got separated from her parents. Okay, what else? And then when she grows up, she's automatically like a smuggler and a mercenary. Like, how'd you get to that point? Like, there's so much padding.
Actually, major plot hole, by the way.
Why?
Major, that time jump between young Erso and older Jyn Erso.
Why do you think it's a plot hole? I don't think it's a plot hole. I just think like they just did a major skip and there was like no in between of like how she got there. Why do you think it's a plot hole?
Because just exactly that. Like, I want to know, like, more about her background. Like, what's her purpose more of being in the film rather than talking about the side characters? Because I never bought Jyn Erso until I saw her watching the hologram. Because when she was young and decided to allegedly go back to see her mother die, Jyn never mentions her ever again in the film.
Never again, but it's all about daddy.
Yeah, it's all about daddy issues.
All right, I will say that I do agree that I would have liked more development for Jyn. You know, she isn't as developed as she should be. None of the main characters in the Rogue One squad are, but that's just because they're trying to they're trying to have it be a story-heavy movie, you know, and they don't have time to develop all the characters. I mean, I'm not trying to... They still should have.
That's actually another issue, which I'll get to later, but I see what you're saying about it. Okay, so let me just lay this out here before I go any further. I am not a huge fan of war films. I'm not. They never appealed to me, and there's just some that rubbed me the wrong way. And I know some people are like, what about Saving Private Ryan? What about this? Blah, blah, blah. Okay, I will say, from a filmmaking standpoint, they're done really well. But they just don't appeal to me personally. It's not... These aren't movies that I would go back and watch over and over again. But I can respect what they were doing with the war films, what the message is, and how horrible they are and stuff like that. Like, casualties, family, whatever. So, I know that, you know, you said that the one thing that you really liked about this movie, that it felt more like a war film. That is something that I don't really care about seeing in a Star Wars film. I'm not saying that it shouldn't happen, because like I said, I think Star Wars should appeal to all generations, because that's what it was supposed to, appeal to all to different audiences, families, whatever. So for me personally, that's just not something that I want to see. That's not something that, like, draws me in, honestly. I'm an OG, and I think Ruby is too. We're like OG Star Wars guys. We like the whimsical. We liked, you know, colorful characters. We like getting into more of the fantasy type stuff with the Jedi and the lightsabers. The corny dialogue can go away.
Not if they're gonna do the same fucking story all over and over again. Sand. We gotta get in our ships and blow up the big station and, oh, Jesus Christ, can we have a different story? Oh, look, a war movie for Star Wars? Perfect. You know, it's a new angle, a new aspect that you need to have, because at the end of the day, it is a fucking war in between the Imperials and the Rebels. It is a war, so we need to see some war.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so the one thing I never understood, though... I don't know why you don't think that they didn't have any... I mean, okay, you did explain it in the beginning that they got into more details about the camps and, you know, casualties and lives and stuff like that. Okay, yeah, sure. It's interesting to see that in a Star Wars movie, but you still got a sense in the other movies that they're in the middle of a war. This is stuff that they had to deal with for decades. The mm-hmm. Empire reigning over innocent people across the galaxy, different planets, and the rebellion trying to stop them. And there is freaking spaceships blasting each other, they have guns blasting each other. I mean, yes, you have the Jedi stuff, other stuff, but you got a sense still that it was a war film. They were dealing with war. So I think the only thing, like I said, I think it's just because you guys want the more grimy stuff, you want the more intense stuff, you want the close calls and like
stuff
like that.
It felt more infantry-like in this movie. And that's what I liked. It was more like personal, more like the lost, forgotten heroes of the rebellion type of thing, instead of these big personalities of, hey, I'm, you know, the chosen one. Hey, I'm the swashbuckling pirate. Hey, I'm the, you know, I'm the princess. You know, like, you're just like, hey, we're normal people in this rebellion, and we're trying to do this impossible task in order to help the universe.
Yes, that is all a great idea in concept. The problem is, in this movie, I don't get to know any of these people that you're talking about for me to care about what's going on.
They should have developed them more, but I'm able to look over it because of the fact that all of the characters were still likable. To me, I still found them likable, even though I didn't know a lot about them. Mm-hmm. And I felt it sort of fit because they're like the lost, you know, heroes of the rebellion, you know? They're like the unsung heroes.
Mm. Yes, that's cool too, but however, that's a problem with that too. Because like I was about to say, they kind of shot themselves in the foot a little bit, because we know this is a prologue to A New Hope, so we know these characters are not going to come back. And then, they're not lost heroes. People know who they are. They don't talk about them in the original trilogy. They don't talk about them in The Force Awakens or The Last Jedi. Why are we supposed to care about this stuff? I mean, yes, it's important for them to get the plans of the Death Star, but it's like, it just doesn't feel like this story needed a 2-hour epic film for us to explain that. This feels like something, this feels like a one-off thing. This feels like a TV show. Like Ruby said, it feels like something that should be like on a Netflix or Disney streaming service thing, if you want to fill in gaps about that, or a TV show like Rebels or Clone Wars.
in an epic 2-hour film that's supposed to be on the same level as the numerical films, it just doesn't feel as important, even though it, they want to make it feel like it's important. It just feels like filler until the last 45, 50 minutes.
I don't know. Personally, I still felt like it was important just because of all of the world building and just really adding on to the original trilogy. And I sort of liked the sort of tragic feel of it, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Like, you sort of know that this is a one-off, but it's still shocking when you see it all finally go down.
Right. So, I'm not saying you're wrong for feeling that, because, like, some people gravitate more towards that. So, that's great if you got a feeling from that. And I think that's cool that Star Wars can convey that emotion for people. But like I said, for me and for Ruby, and I think for other people in the Star Wars fam as well, I guess we're just so used to the traditional structure of how the numerical films are. And I know you were throwing some shade at The Force Awakens because everyone's saying it feels like A New Hope. My argument, I'm going to keep saying this, I'm going to say it in our Force Awakens podcast as well. Yes, it was a similar structure to A New Hope, but what made me overlook that fact is because the characters they introduced in that film are different from the characters from Leia, Han, and Luke. I know people in the comments are about to be like, they're not that interesting. Okay, well, for me, in The Force Awakens, they were very strong characters. They were very interesting, and I wanted to see more from them. And I cared about if they were in danger or not. And you knew that you were going to see more from these people going forward. I just didn't convey that emotion with Rogue One, because we know this is the only film, this is the only time we're going to see these characters. And so it's like, if you're going to do that, at least develop them more, you know? So that's just, I just didn't feel that from this movie. So that's why it just keeps me from being like, this is better than the other movies at that level.
I mean, I still love traditional Star Wars. It's just nice to see something different.
Yeah. Okay, so let's talk about Forrest Whitaker's Saw Gerrera.
He was really good, but we needed more from him. He needed more to do. I liked the fact that he was an extremist rebel. You know, sort of like an anti-hero of the rebellion.
Mm. Yes. And they explore more of that in the Clone Wars and the Rebels TV show. He's actually a really cool character in those TV shows.
Yeah, I still need to see
So that. I was really excited when Forrest Whitaker was going to play him in this movie. But he was wasted.
That was funny. He's my least favorite character in the whole movie.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow.
I didn't dislike him. It's just that he didn't do a ton.
Like, I don't even blame you for thinking that, too. Have you watched the him and Rebels? And oh, yeah. So, definitely.
Who are you talking to?
Huh? Honestly. Da-da-da. But so it's like, same thing with General Grievous. You watch him in this movie, you're probably thinking, like, okay, yeah, he was pretty
General
solid.
Grievous or General Grievous?
I keep calling him Grievous.
People say it both ways.
I don't know. I'm just looking at the spelling, and it's like Grievous. If people want to correct us in the comments, please do. But
yeah. I think people do say Grievous, but
I thought that's what Palpatine said in Episode 3 when in the hologram, General Grievous.
Yeah,
I don't know.
Whatever.
Anyway, same thing with him. Like, if you just watched him in Revenge of the Sith, you think, oh yeah, he's really cool. But then if you watch the stuff in Clone Wars and Rebels, you're gonna think, oh, he was wasted. This is a drop-off. This is exactly how I felt about Saw Gerrera, except I thought this was worse. He did practically nothing in this movie, and that kind of made me mad, because why would you cast such a great actor like Forrest Whitaker and give him nothing to do? And plus, the groundwork for his character is there. He's a freaking extremist that used to be for the Rebellion and played an important role in the Rebellion, and then he went off to become an extremist. Like, they don't explore that at all. It's just in talking like, oh yeah, he used to be with us, but then he went and did his own thing.
I guess they just have too much to cover. They're like, oh, if you want more, go see the Clone Wars.
Why don't you fix that padding in the first hour with nothing happening? Shit. But, yeah, so that really frustrated me, because I was really excited to see what he was going to do. Like, you couldn't at least have him help Jin and the rest of the, you know, the team with the Death Star plans. You couldn't have him tag along or something, but no, he's just like, I will sacrifice myself! I will not run anymore!
For what?
Well, technically you did, because instead of helping them in the Rebellion, you decided to stay forth and die from the Death Star blast, so, okay.
Yeah, sacrificing yourself. For what?
Mm-mm. No.
For what?
For what?
for what? Okay, so going back to the main... Oh, there was one character we didn't talk about. Who's that Hispanic dude that was with K2SO?
Oh, we're talking about...
Cassian,
yeah, I hated him.
He sucked.
Yeah, I didn't like him at all. He's not likable. I mean, yes, he has to make those close calls that aren't, you know, popular, but it's just, he was just an unlikable character to me. Yes, there was some sympathy towards him when they're about to die. Okay, that don't matter then. But up until that point, he's just being a jerk to everyone. It's like, I understand, it's war, and it's like, he's just seen so much, and...
Yeah, and he's been, like, you know, been dealing with it since he was a kid, so he's naturally a cold character because of that.
Yes. Now, what would have helped me to get more with this character more is like, okay, we're going to go back to the cliches that people claim that they don't want to see in this movie. I just wanted a moment where Cassian and Jin and maybe the rest of the crew just sat down and just talked, you know, just have a conversation about his past life, some of the hardships. You don't even have to do flashbacks, but just have a natural conversation. Just talk about, yeah, I've been through this, and I've been through a lot of shit. That's why I act this way. I don't mean to act this way, but it's just war, and I have to be cold because the Empire is like cutthroat, and I have to be just as cutthroat to survive. Something like that. I know that's probably too sappy for people, and it's like, oh, exposition, blah, blah, blah.
He tried that a little bit when he was talking to Jin.
But it wasn't enough because he's still being a jerk after that until before they die.
So yeah, the execution in that reveal was terrible.
I just didn't like him at all. And also, adding more fuel to the fire, apparently Lucasfilm wants to do a spin-off show with him on Disney Plus.
No.
Absolutely not. And you overlooked Donnie Yen's character? You overlooked Donnie Yen's character, who is more interesting and has more connections to the Force. And there's just so much lore with him alone, even though we don't know that much about him. There's still more interesting stuff to know about him. And also, you could appeal to other people across the world, you know, like in China or Japan. There's Donnie Yen there. Or somebody, you know, an Asian character. You could appeal to more ethnicities with them instead of doing this stupid Cassian Nobody cares about Cassian.
Well, Cassian could be in the Solo sequel.
Are you serious?
sure,
for fan service, I guess. Why not? But he will be younger at that time, right?
Yeah, but I mean, not a ton. He would still be about the same age.
Yeah, right? I guess. And then,
Solo doesn't take place too much before Rogue One.
Okay, it'd be a competition with Han and Chewie versus K2SO and Cassian or some shit like that. Okay, well, sure, they can do that, but I don't care about seeing a full Cassian show.
No, that's not necessary. He's not an interesting enough character. Mm. He was serviceable enough as, you know, sort of the rogue leader.
Rogue!
But,
yeah,
he was just fine.
And then as for the other, who is that pilot?
Yeah, I don't remember his name.
Jeez, I don't. I'm
the one that got shot in the very beginning of the.
The Imperial defector pilot.
What's the actor's name?
Riz Ahmed. Okay, so I really like Riz Ahmed. I like him as an actor, but once again, another character I didn't care about. I mean,
his character was bland. Everybody was bland.
Mostly everyone was bland. Outside of K2SO and Donnie's character. And I guess you could say his friend to an extent. But, like, everyone is bland. Riz Ahmed was bland this movie. He barely had anything to do except for, fly the pilot ship and give us the name of the movie. Like, what's your squad unit name? Rogue One? Rogue One? There is no Rogue One! Really? I know we're talking about...
He could have said anything.
Anything, but Rogue One? I know we were talking about in the Solo thing, I'm alone. Okay, Han Solo, this was almost as bad as that. Just out of nowhere. I thought it was going to be something more interesting, a little more grand, but no. All this is fan service, you know, because the Empire is like, can you hear me? This is Rogue 2. Can you hear me?
Are you out there, Han? And look, this is Rogue 2.
That's the first thing I thought, too. When I heard that Rogue 1 was going to be the title of the film, I thought that was going to be
Oh, really? They say Empire Rogue 2 and Empire? I totally forgot about that.
This is all this fancy. Yes, Rogue 1. Yeah. And I thought I thought Rogue 2 was going to make an appearance in this movie, and he doesn't. I'm like, you missed it! You missed the opportunity! What is wrong with you? God! That's another thing I want to talk about, fan service. There's some fan service in this movie that I liked, like the smugglers from the A New Hope, that was nice, and then seeing Organa and Mothma, that was cool. But then there was the other cameos where I'm just like, okay, that was unnecessary. Like, why is C-3PO and R2-D2 there?
C-3PO and R2, thank you.
In the battle, when the ships are about to fly off and go into battle, there's C-3PO and R2-D2 there in the hangar. I'm like, wait, why are you there?
They're on the ship at the beginning of episode 4.
I mean, yes, but I just felt they didn't need to be at that place. Like, I think the camera would have worked better if they were at that ship with Leia, because that's where they end up in A New Hope. That would have made more sense of them being in the middle of the battle, and they're like, oh, we got these droids there. Oh, I guess we gotta move them, so let's take them to Leia. Like, when do they have time to do that? Like, stupid. Like, that stuff like that just doesn't make any sense. And then, there's this crystal thing that Mads Mikkelsen gives Jin in this movie, and it's like, oh, that's cool. They don't talk about it at all. A freaking kyber crystal. You'd say nothing about it. Where do you get the kyber crystal from? Like, they don't have to spend like 20 minutes on it, but just a little dialogue being like, I got this from a temple or something, because Donnie Yen's character defends the temple there, so why don't they put the connection there? And then, oh, more a connection between Donnie Yen and Jin's character, there you go.
What's the crystal do?
The kyber crystals are what is used to power the lightsabers.
Oh, it's those, okay.
Yeah, so they missed an opportunity with that, and then they talk about them being the defenders of the temple. Why are you not at the temple? Why are you there? Why are you in, why are you on, what's the name of that planet? Jedha? Why are you on Jedha? Did you think it was destiny? Like, Donnie and the Force called me here. We have to be here because we got to help with the Rogue One and stuff like that. So, like, okay, sure.
The Force told me to be here.
Fine. That's fine. I'll accept that. That's all right. But it's just like, there's so many missed opportunities in this movie. Oh, another thing that I don't know why this scene was in here, and watching it a couple days ago, I'm still like, what is this scene? I never thought in a million years that I would see hentai in a Star Wars film. What was that tentacle thing wrapping over me? Then freaking Saw Gerrera's like, it will make you tell the truth. It sees all. And then this weird, gross tentacle thing just swarming around him, getting in his ears. I'm like, what the heck is this? What is this? You couldn't do no truth serum? There's no such thing as truth serum. It's technically truth serum. Why couldn't you do truth serum? You have to get this big, fat, ugly, slimy, tentacle monster.
Yeah, I will say, that part was completely pointless. You're talking about the pilot, right?
Yes.
Yeah, with the pilot, yeah. And then it doesn't go anywhere.
Yeah, I did, like, that's the only time we see it, and then it's not brought up.
Yeah, so that could have been completely cut out,
And then he's still recovering from a hangover from getting face-fucked by the thing in the cage. I'm like, oh my god, what the heck?
You still see him wet in the cage.
Oh god, oh man. I dare any defenders of this movie to defend that scene. Defend it, I dare you. Go in the comments and defend it. This tentacle scene was absolutely necessary to the film.
No.
God, I was like, what is
this thing? It's in the comics. Yeah, where?
Who cares? You have so many.
About the comics?
Who cares? You have so many creatures. You could have used anything else but that thing. Like, I like the red tentacle thing in The Force Awakens. I thought that was a fun little scene. Was it necessary? No. But it was still fun, and I wasn't taken out of it. This thing, I was like, why is this happening?
See, if they used that red creature from The Force Awakens in Rogue One instead of what they did, that would actually be really cool.
Yeah. Though I think they wanted to have more you know, different types of species. They want to have more variety.
Yeah. They want to be separate from the numerical films. Blah, blah, blah.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. How about the fact that there's no opening crawl? It's just,
I hate that.
It's just bang.
That was hands down the
I
worst thing about that
I fucking loved that. That was awesome.
That.
Like, you don't expect it, and it just goes right along with the theme of this movie. You know, shit's going to happen that you're not going to expect. The movie starts with a bang and ends with a bang. Fuck yeah.
Yeah, but at the same time, that's like, that opening crawl is like the icon of Star Wars. Like, that's something that's
we don't need
like
no. We don't need a written exposition. We're going to show you what's happening.
They had, like, instead of, like, a long time ago in the galaxy far, far away, they went right immediately into the crawl in that same font and text. While that is a crawl, it's still separate from the numerical films. I like that. To have there be no crawl in Rogue One, I would have left that theater immediately.
But you didn't. You stayed all throughout.
It's like, bye.
So,
Hell yeah, we don't need writing.
Let's oh gosh. Go. Okay, so I'm of two minds of this thing. I'm the mediator on this, okay? So, I'm kind of like Ruby. It was really jarring seeing no text in this movie because, like I said, all the other films did it. So
it did
like take me off guard. Like, oh, just and then we're on this planet. Oh, okay. And then later on, like, I'm like, okay, that was weird. That was strange. But at the same,
that logo and font that they used for
that was
Rogue
really
One,
cheap. That was
that
cheap.
That was so bad.
It looked like something they did last minute on Photoshop. Like, oh, we need to put the logo.
Yeah, like something I would do something better than that.
Like the like the logo in Solo was so much better than that. I'm like,
yes.
Like, what is that? Now,
that was so bad.
Yes, but at the same time, I don't. If they're trying to be different from the numerical film structurally, then I think it's fine for them not to have a crawl. I think it makes the crawls in the numerical films even more special because, you know, it's numerical films. It's like this the main plot and stuff like that. So, so I'm fine with them not having a crawl. It's like, it's not, I mean, yes, it's a like a vintage thing in Star Wars, but like this is a different type of Star Wars film, so like have a different tone and stuff like that. That's fine. Like, I think the more iconic thing about it is not the crawl. It's a long time ago in the galaxy far, far away. I think that's,
and they kept that.
They kept that. I think if you just have that, we would know automatically, yep, that's a Star Wars movie. Go ahead, Crimson. Sorry.
I like the fact that they didn't have a crawl.
Mm-hmm.
But I disagree. I do think that the iconic thing is the crawl.
I mean, yes.
I know that a long time ago in a galaxy far, far away is like the most famous thing.
Mm-hmm.
Pretty much the most famous thing from Star Wars.
Mm-hmm.
But like, I personally, at first, I was really mad that they didn't have a crawl. I remember sitting in the theater thinking, what the fuck? Why didn't they have a crawl?
Mm-hmm.
But I'm okay with it now.
Yeah, I was thinking that too, but I was like, no, I love it.
First of all,
you
could
tell everyone in that theater was like, what the fuck?
Like, huh?
Everyone was screaming
first of all,
at that
I
moment.
Hate Solo.
I was screaming there.
Yeah, I know y'all hate Solo.
Yeah,
I
hate Solo.
So first of all, I hate Solo.
And y'all can
so
still
really
go to hell.
I'm glad that Solo didn't
You glad that Solo didn't have a crawl?
Yeah.
Okay.
So I'm really glad that Solo didn't, because I think that would have pissed me off. But, like, I do agree. I think that it should be just the, like, the main story movies,
mm-hmm.
that should have the crawl, because that's
no Solo had a crawl. It had those. It had the text like in the same format and everything. Like, it had it in the three separate paragraphs.
Oh yeah, they had that little thing.
Oh, they
yeah.
did have a little bit of a crawl. You're right.
Yeah, so if they did
really
that
solo.
With Rogue
it's
One,
kind of
it's not like a crawl. It's just like
but
a.
They did it.
So for me, it doesn't count.
Yeah.
Well, keep in mind, I've only seen that movie like one time all the way through because I keep falling asleep. So.
Still like Solo, y'all can suck it. Anyway, but yeah, it's like, it's not really a crawl, that's like a paragraph,
yeah.
like a prologue. I think, since there's not a lot of context in Rogue One, it would have been nice to have a little paragraph explaining what's going on. I think the problem with them not having a crawl in this movie is just the way they structured it was kind of awkward, because like I said, it's a long time ago in a galaxy far, far away, and then, oh, okay, we're here. And then,
can I just say that the opening music, like when you first hear it, it's like sex?
No.
What?
No, okay.
It's like awesome.
No, that's another problem.
Every time I watch Star Wars, I'm like, ugh.
Oh, you're talking about the main crawl when it did.
Yeah. That's okay. What I thought you were just talking about.
No, I'm talking about the stuff in Rogue One. But yeah, I agree. When we hear the in the numerical moves, I'm like, oh yes.
I don't even care about the crawl at that point. Okay, it's just like, oh my god, the music's like sex.
Mm-hmm.
Can't wait to hear it one more time in December.
One more time, baby.
One last ride.
Yeah, and then the Game of Thrones writers are gonna take over the next trilogy.
Fuck those bitches!
So I know that the last season of Game of Thrones was very disappointing.
It was very bad.
I still didn't see it, so.
Apparently Rian Johnson is still wanting to do more Star Wars too.
Rian Johnson is banned.
Mm-hmm.
He needs to get hit with a bus so he can.
We'll get to that in The Last Jedi. Yes, moving on!
We will. Anyway, that's another problem I want to talk about. The score in this movie was not that good to me.
What?
Oh, in Rogue One?
In Rogue One.
Yeah, I kind of agree. What? I thought the music was kind of boring.
Yeah, it was very forgettable. It's not that it was awful, because I've heard worse scores. Amazing Spider-Man 2. But it's like, it was just so bland and weirdly placed. Like, I heard some people didn't care for the score in The Force Awakens, and I'm like, are you kidding me right now? That Kylo Ren theme? Rey's theme? Like,
yeah, Rey's theme? You like, want to fight?
Excuse me? But this movie is just like, okay, this is probably just me. It's just a personal thing for me. It's not exactly an issue, but I'm just like, every time I hear Jyn Erso's theme, I want to claw my eyes out. I don't know what it is. It's probably that aberrant. I don't know. Every every time I hear that, I'm like, oh my god, stop!
And it's Michael whatever his name is.
Yeah, Michael
Giacchino.
Michael
Giacchino,
yeah.
Something. Yeah, who did the Star Trek reboot score.
See, the score in that is awesome.
Yeah.
Those are great, but this one, I'm like, what happened? I heard that he didn't have a lot of time to do the score for this movie, so it's like he was trying to do the best he can. So I'm like, I'll give him the benefit of the doubt on that. But it's just, that being said, I'm just like, the score was just very forgettable, and then it's weirdly placed. Like, triumphant songs are just like jarringly just put in places, like when the Rogue One logo comes up, it's like da, 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 da. And this is right before the grimy I just took your father away and killed your mother eerie scene, and then da, 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 da. I'm like,
bright colors, popcorn candy, yeah.
What is going on? And then you have the weird tuba themes in the battle sequence, like when they're running on the beach from the 80s. So you hear this, bow, 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 bow. I'm like, what? What is this score?
I mean,
that's the rebellion.
I don't really remember the score, so I guess it's not.
Exactly, really, you don't remember.
Yeah, I guess it's not memorable. But it didn't stick out to me like it did to you.
Mm.
It didn't bother me.
Now, the only times that I thought was really good was when they did scores from the other movies, like Darth Vader's theme and the Mustafar theme, and
so glad Mustafar was in this movie.
The what?
The Force theme.
Yeah, the Force theme. Yeah, I thought, okay, yeah, great. And then we go back to the weirdly place. And the Rebellion theme. I'm like, okay, that's cool. It's just the score was just all over the place for me. It just did not work.
Darth Vader's tower on Mustafar was fucking sweet.
Oh, that's a nice transition. Let's talk about Darth Vader. Okay, so when we first... Yeah, go onto that planet and it's full of lava. I'm like, is that Mustafar? And then I hear the theme from Mustafar. I'm like, we're on Mustafar. And then the ship lands on a castle. Like, Darth Vader's castle. My I was like shaking in my chair. I'm like, oh my god.
Take that, prequel haters.
Yeah, take that. Like, the callbacks to the prequels were awesome, man. And that took the cake for me. Going back to Mustafar and seeing Darth Vader's castle, that's the first time we seeing Darth Vader's castle on the big screen. And it was just amazing. And then you have the, like, whatever his minion in a hood,
talking to Vader, being like, oh, Krennic's here to talk to you, and he's in this tube, and it's like, you don't see anything, but you just see the minion talking to him, and he's just like, Lord Vader, Krennic's here to speak with you, and then the tube just lowers, and then you see, like, the ice melting, and you see Vader's deformed body hanged up on, like, wires and stuff like that, and I'm just like, chills up and down the spine, man.
This film would have been rated R if they showed, like, his actual body instead of just showing, like, his forehead.
Right, right. You know, we gotta keep it for the kids, man.
But unrated anyway,
keep it for the kids.
Unrated cut. Oh, man. It's, I actually believe they can do a rated R Rogue One.
Oh, yeah.
They could do it. But yeah, and then Darth Vader in his full uniform comes out, we know, with the, in the silhouettes, just walking towards, and it's just, oh, God. That's literal sex right there. Just him walking up to Krennic. Oh my God!
Oh, and then at the end where he's like,
"Freeze!"
Oh, hold on. We will get to that scene. But yeah, just like his suit looked.
Get there faster.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, because like we'll get there. But
so let's be real. That's the best scene in the whole movie.
Yes, I agree. But yes, like Darth Vader's suit looked awesome. It looked amazing. I like the red like tint coming from his eyes. One little nitpick, though. One little tiny nitpick. I think his helmet was a little too big.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's just...
No, it's his body was too small.
You know what it is? When I was watching the credits last night, there are two different actors physically in the suit in this movie.
Oh, really?
Yes.
Yeah, so there are some scenes where,
both of those scenes.
There are some scenes where, to me, he looks shorter than he did.
The Mustafar actor and then the end scene actor.
Yeah.
Okay. I didn't even notice that, actually. Yeah. So that makes sense, because yeah, I was looking at him and it's like, I guess his body was not proportionate to his helmet, so I'm like, is this helmet really big, or is just him looking scrawnier? But okay, I don't know why they couldn't just use the same actor, well, reshoots, so okay.
Yeah, or the new guy at the end, you know, what was more, could do more physical stuff than the Mustafar guy or something, I don't know.
I guess.
Yes, yeah, Spencer Wilding and Daniel Napros.
Which one was the Mustafar one?
I think it was Daniel Napros, because Spencer Wilding looks big.
Yeah. And he was towering over Krennic. I was like, oh, yes, they got the side right and everything. And hearing James Earl Jones' voice coming out of Vader, it was just, oh,
that was
great.
That was fire.
That was awesome. One other little nitpick, though, about James Earl Jones, and this is something I'm actually kind of worried about in the Lion King remake. He kind of sounded a little bit aged.
Yeah,
his voice sounded a little different.
Yeah. So, I think it worked better with the Lion King remake, but this one, I'm like, you don't think so?
No. They completely changed the cast, and then they just left him as Mufasa. I don't like that.
Yeah, I don't agree with that either.
I really don't see why you guys are upset about that.
Because
We'll talk about it.
We'll talk about it, but it's like,
it's not even a big part, and his voice is iconic, so they wanted to keep some sort of continuity.
Okay, but
there's other people that have a commanding presence with their voice.
Yeah.
He's not the only one.
I think Timon and Pumbaa are iconic, so why didn't they bring them back?
What about Scar?
Or Scar.
You freaking Jeremy Irons. Like, come
or
on.
Rafiki.
I would have had him as a woman to homage the stage play, but that's just me.
I agree with you.
But, anyway, you're talking about Star Wars.
Yeah, we got off track.
Yeah. But, yeah, James Earl Jones just sounded a little bit aged. I think, for me, I would have got the voice actor who did Vader in the Rebels TV show, because he sounded a lot younger. Yeah, he sounded great.
Oh, I haven't heard of him, but no, I'm glad they got Jones.
Yeah, because it was nice to hear him again.
I thought that was James Earl Jones on Rebels.
Nope, it was a different actor.
That's someone else?
Yeah.
Let me look him up.
Mm-hmm.
You keep talking, I'll look him up.
Yeah. See, now, if Rebels can recast Darth Vader, they could do the same thing with Lion King. Mm-hmm. Anyway. And we don't see him for an hour and 15 minutes into the movie.
Darth Vader?
Yes.
That's fine, it's not the central focus.
I mean, I'm not expecting him to be the central focus, but here's the problem with it. Again, I'm going to compare The Force Awakens. I know people didn't like Luke was only in it in the last minute of the film. But why does that not bother me as much as it does with Darth Vader in Rogue One? I'm going to go back. Because the characters in The Force Awakens were still really good. So Mark Hamill didn't cast an entire shadow of this movie because I was following the characters that were more interesting. Jyn Erso and all these other characters aren't bringing me into this movie enough to be like, I can wait for Darth Vader. The whole time I was like, when's Darth Vader coming? When's Darth Vader coming? Why isn't Darth Vader here yet? We're an hour in and I still don't see him. Now from...
That didn't bother me like that because I was interested enough in what they were doing with the... You know, with the Death Star and, you know, them trying to get the plans. I don't know, I just thought.
I mean, that's cool, but it can only go so far if you care about the characters. Anyway, we're going to agree to disagree on that constantly.
But you know what? I agree they should have developed
gonna
the characters more.
I was going to disagree with you, but I agree with you.
With which point?
About how I was just waiting for Darth Vader. Because the characters... Mm. I mean, if you kind of think about it, the characters aren't great.
Yeah, they're not developed enough. I totally agree. I still thought that they were likable, though.
They were likable, and they were passable.
Yes.
I think the best characters in the whole movie were, what's his name, K2SO?
Mm-hmm.
K2SO, and then Chirrut, the Asian guy.
See? I'm not crazy. That's exactly what I said.
He's my favorite character in the whole movie.
Yes.
What's his name?
Chirrut.
Yeah. Okay. So, I'm literally not the only one on this. K2SO and Chirrut are literally the most interesting characters in the movie.
They're the best characters.
I can't even say... Thought. Yeah, exactly.
He's a droid and he has more personality than...
Than the human characters?
And Krennic.
And Krennic?
I like Krennic.
I mean, yeah, I guess so. If you like the mustache twirling... It was
funny. It was entertaining.
Now, the problem... I can't even say Darth Vader in this movie is a character. He's a plot device. He's not even a character. He doesn't do anything to progress the plot outside of the stuff that has to happen for A New Hope. Like, if he was taken out of the movie, it really wouldn't change that much.
Well,
except for the reshoot stuff.
I don't want Darth Vader to overshadow the rest of the movie.
He doesn't have to be, but you know Darth Vader is an important part of the Death Star stuff. Why couldn't he be in Tarkin's place? He's not in the movie that much, but you know he's still there. Why couldn't they switch places and have Tarkin not be in the movie as much and have Vader in it? So at least feel like he's there outside of fan service.
Yeah, but in episode 4, Tarkin is in charge of the Death Star. So you see him basically screw over Krennic and take it from him.
Yes. It was just really frustrating because, like, I wouldn't be hearkening on this if I just gave a crap about that first hour. Then I wouldn't care if Darth Vader came in an hour and 15 minutes in. I wouldn't even care if he came in the last 5 minutes. But if the first hour just, it was Phantom Menace level boring.
Man. I don't agree. I didn't think it was that boring.
I actually agree with you, and I liked the movie.
Mm-hmm.
But I agree.
I mean, it was kind of slow, but I didn't think it was that bad.
It was so slow.
All right, guys.
Solo.
I looked at my phone the whole time, and I still understood what was going on.
Yeah. Like, I'm sorry, man. It's like, I tried, man.
Yeah.
I tried, but I'm just like, there's nothing happening except them just building the pieces together so we can get to the end fight. That's literally what it is. But they could have took a shorter time doing that. There was not even a reason for them to go on that rain planet, wherever they went on, instead of just, reuniting with the dad. But that wasn't really that emotional of a scene. The hologram stuff with Jyn crying was more impactful for them, except more than them meeting for the first time.
Yeah, notice how she, like, acted more upset when she saw the hologram than when he died.
Yeah, that was...
Like, that didn't make any sense.
Yeah,
like, literally, if we went from Jeddah, where Saw was, straight to that planet at the end with the palm trees, it would have been just fine.
Yeah.
Like, I don't know why
From Jeddah to Scarif?
To Scarif, yes.
Yeah, honestly, yeah, that other planet wasn't totally necessary.
And, like, why did Galen have to die? That's what
He didn't have to die.
He didn't. It just didn't make any sense.
Mm-hmm. And if he was going to die, I think it would have been even more a shot in the gut if in the hologram he died during the hologram.
Yeah,
he died
got
shot.
The hologram. That's how you change it. That's how you...
Yeah, that would have been more interesting.
Yeah, so then I would have felt more with it, but yeah, it just fell flat for me. All right, so let's get to the final battle, because I know it's what we want to talk about. The final battle.
On what planet is that again? I forget.
Scarif. Yes. Awesome.
The Battle of Scarif is possibly my favorite battle in the entire saga.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I still love the final battle in Return of the Jedi.
Oh, that's
though.
Like second for me. I think this might be number one.
Okay. I can see why you're saying that, because literally, like, the shots in that final fight is just awesome. Like, even when the rebels come in from light speed and just...
Yeah.
I'm like, oh my god!
And it's just an amazing mix of, like, the ships and then also the ground stuff. I love both.
Like, the AT-ATs coming back and, like, shooting on the beach. Like, that's really cool.
And I love how, Oh, what's his name? Donnie Yen. What's his name? Chiru has to tell Blaze, come on, get out of the way. He's a blind guy. Did he notice the AT-AT? He's like, Blaze, move.
And yeah. then he had that run. Yeah. And then he took that cross guard blaster and was like looking the other way and blasting his ship in the sky. I'm like, yeah, you get it, Chiru. Get it. So I'm like, yeah, that was just awesome. And, honestly, I didn't care about Jin and Cassian sneaking into the Death Star. Like, that kind of, like, stopped the momentum of the movie for me. Until K2SO was in danger trying to hold the door together.
Are you talking about the building?
Yeah, the building when they're trying to get the plans and transfer it to the ship. So that was the only time I'm like, oh, yes! Because K2SO was getting shot to hell. I'm like, no, don't die! No,
that was
no.
tragic.
That was the most tragic death in the entire movie. How? How? I was literally like, no, don't!
No.
But what do you think?
Chirrut's death was more...
Yeah.
That one was, too.
I mean, yes, because I felt for him, but I think just the way the scene was structured with K2SO, with him just trying his hardest to keep the door locked and blasting the stormtroopers away, it just felt more intense than the Donnie Yen stuff to me.
And also, if I could just throw in one thing, and this is going to be my most controversial opinion. I know every single person is going to disagree with me on this.
All right, here we go. What is...
But I, oh my god, I'm even afraid of saying this.
Go ahead.
Even if K2SO had like a really cool sequence at the end of the film, like his sacrifice was cool, did not care about the character. I personally did not think he was that great.
Okay, that's where we have to draw a patch,
that is
Ruby.
Personal opinion, I just found him annoying throughout the entire film until he sacrificed himself.
Did you think he was worse than L337?
No.
As bad, not worse.
What? But, no, yeah. no, you get out. Oh, get fuck. Off. Get off of close, this panel right now.
L3 is worse. L3 is worse, but K2SO is not.
But you're saying he's almost there. Like, oh, man.
Well, then again, L3. You also have BB-8. You have 3. I personally like 3PO. I thought that he was...
I do, too.
Yeah, I like 3PO.
But, and R2 is very close to my heart.
3PO is the most useless, annoying piece of trash I've ever seen.
But he's still fun to watch.
He translates
for them.
He
is fun to watch. And Anthony Daniels actually pulls off the role nicely. He's more of an icon with his character. With Alan Tudyk. Alan Tudyk did K2SO. I felt more for Anthony Daniels' portrayal of 3CPO than Alan Tudyk's
K2SO. Get out of here.
And I understand why you say that, because 3PO was in more movies and he had better development. So it's like, that's...
Well, it's not only that. He had more of a... I felt like 3PO had more of a connection with his main line of characters. Like 3PO, Han, Leia. I felt like he had better moments with his characters than K2SO had moments with his line of characters.
Yeah, I agree with you on that. Though it's just like, for what they did in this movie, I just found him really cool. And I thought he was... I think he was just as practical and important as, like an R2-D2 and BB-8. I thought he was, you know, he did stuff, you know? Which, what Crimson will say, 3PO doesn't do anything.
It was kind of nice how,
like... Yeah, like, at the end of the film, yes, he did do stuff. But, like, on, Jeddah, that line where he said, "Did you know that wasn't me?" Like...
That was funny, man.
I facepalmed myself when I heard that.
That was funny.
I don't know about you guys, but I facepalmed when I heard that.
You facepalmed in that, but you love the humor in The Last Jedi.
Yes.
Oh, no. Yes. Excuse me?
We'll get to that in November.
Oh, I'm about to stab you. What?
Yes, the humor in Last Jedi was a lot better than in Rogue One, boy.
You're about to be outnumbered in November.
Oh, okay, okay.
And Nick is going to defend me on that, too.
We like the humor, too? What?
No.
No, absolutely not.
Let's fucking go.
Oh, we're about to go. Anyway...
Let's get back to Rogue One before we start ripping each other's heads off. Anyway, let's go to Rogue One. So after that controversial statement, so okay, where were we? The battle. Anyway, yeah. So anyway, like when K2SO started to die, that's when I started to be like, oh, okay, now I'm actually on the edge of my feet, and like, oh, that was really sad. And they got the plans. Once again, the music just started getting weird. Like, I don't know what it was, but it was like, dun, dun,
dun, dun, dun, dun. It was just so weird.
It was like, what is this? And then I'm gonna use it again. It was forced when Krennic was like trying to stop them in the thing. I was like, I almost forgot he was in this movie.
Yeah.
Like, I just felt it was unnecessary being like, I will stop you. You lost. Your signal will never get to the base. I'm like, okay.
Will never get to the rebels.
So
shield us up.
Oh god. And like, so this is the Ruby. This is the point where I'm like, okay, I don't care about him anymore. Do you notice he's the only one in the Empire that's acting as over the top as he is? I think everyone's just looking at him and be like, why is he acting like that when he's like, get it done, get it done, fuck this ship up. I'm like, what the heck? And even like Tarkin was just looking at him and being like, will you calm the fuck down, please? And even Darth Vader's like, will you calm down?
Careful not to choke on your aspirations, director.
I love that,
that
too.
That was so awesome.
That was so good. but yeah, so... Oh, another thing I didn't mention. They have some species that look similar to Admiral Akbar from Return of the Jedi.
Yeah.
They have some species. That was really cool that they had some species in here that looked like them. And they were also helping commanding the battle. So that was really cool. So they got the Death Star plans to them. And they're transferring it to Leia's ship. And then when Organa and Mothma were walking to evacuate, they're like, we need somebody we can trust with the plans. And then Organa says, I will trust her with my life. You know what we're talking about. Yeah. So they get the plans to that ship, and well, almost anyway, because the soldiers were taking the flash drive thing to the other ship. And this, my favorite scene in the entire movie,
because it's the best scene in the entire movie.
Yes.
Oh my gosh.
It is. Oh my gosh. So they're in a hallway, and the door is
like sex.
The scene is literally sex, and it's like they're trying to get to the other part of the hallway, but the door is locked, and then it blacks out. And the soldiers are like, what's going on? And then you hear breathing. And then his lightsaber ignites.
Red saber.
That red lights up the hallway. And then all the rebels are like, open fire! They try shooting at Vader, but it ain't doing crap. He's deflecting the lightsaber and like using his force powers and lifting them up off the air and choking them and throwing them across the room and freaking slicing people in half while they're in air. And the rebels are just like screaming like, help us! Help! Get it open! And then just Vader is going to town, and they're like literally scratching and clawing to get the flash drive out of here, because Vader is literally feet away from the person holding the flash drive, and he's literally talking to the other guy on the other side being like, take it, take it, and right when they take it,
yeah,
like that was something out of a horror film. Like, that was, oh, that was just nut. That was awesome. Oh god, that was so great.
That was amazing.
Mm-hmm. And then so they get the flash right to the ship, Leia's ship, and then one of the rebel troopers hands it to this lady in the white gown, and it's like, oh, is that? And they hand it to him, and then the soldier's like, okay, we got this thing, what do you think it will be? And then Leia turns around and she says, hope. And then the ship zips off into light speed, and that's the end of the movie. Okay, so...
And the classic theme goes.
Classic theme goes. Okay, so...
Perfect ending.
Yeah, okay.
I thought it was a perfect ending.
Okay, in theory, it was nice, but here's my thing about it. Let me talk about this motion capture stuff a little bit more. So watching this recently, just I couldn't get over the uncanny valley of Tarkin and Leia. Like they tried really hard to make it seem like they were 100% there. But like I said, for me it was probably like 85, 89. It was just something didn't feel right looking at their faces. No, seriously. Like watching this recently, I'm like, okay, I know that's Tarkin, but it's like something doesn't look right. And then right, and then same thing with Leia. It was more apparent with Leia because they were in a bright ship and the light color, so you can see all the imperfections, and it's like, oh, okay.
Now that I will agree with you, but Tarkin, I thought he was flawless. I thought that was the best I've ever seen.
Yeah,
you were in the other room when we mentioned that. Yeah, I think Leia was a little bit off. Tarkin, like, if there was an issue, I couldn't see it. It was nearly perfect.
See, to me, I thought Tarkin looked too blurry.
Yeah. I think
he looked more like perfection, like did in A New Hope, and that was a much older movie.
Yeah, I definitely agree. They're like, I couldn't put a finger on it, but yeah, it did look kind of blurry with them. It's like, and it's probably bad because I looked at some clips from A New Hope with Tarkin in it, and I probably shouldn't have done that because, like, with him, it's like, oh, he's actually there. And then I'm comparing it to this, and I'm like, oh. Oh, wait.
Yeah, I mean, I guess maybe there isn't quite as much detail in the face when you're looking at a CGI face versus an actual face. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, I guess in the scenes with Tarkin, you could tell a little, I guess, just the tiniest.
You agreed with me.
I do agree with you.
But I mean, if there's issues, no, it's not.
Shut up.
No, it's not. And you agree. You said the first hour was a drag. You said the first hour was a drag. Flawless movie, huh? Flawless movie. Anyway.
I mean, I guess I can sort of see what you're saying, that it looked maybe a little...
It's a little off. Like I said,
like
they...
A little blurry,
like, or like a little, like the best CGI cut scene of them in this movie. So they did the best with what they could. I believe that they did the best of what they could. I think the difference between this and them de-aging somebody, like, you still have the person there to do features on it, like an actual person, but they're working off of two people that are deceased. And also, Leia looks a lot younger than what she does now. And so it's like they have to work off of footage that they got, and they have to make a mold off of that. And that's a little bit more challenging than having someone actually there to do the aging, stuff like that. So that's as I feel about it. But I think in the future, we'll see that polished better. You know, because like I said, with the prequels, with the CGI environments, while it looks cool, it doesn't look 100% real, but it still looked great. And like in the future, they're gonna mold it better. And then we got films like Avatar and Jungle Book and Lion King coming up where it looks photorealistic practically. So I think as a first running, it was good.
I still thought it was nearly perfect though. Like you could just can't even really tell.
Some people disagree with you, but
yeah. I can tell that Grand Moff Tarkin doesn't have red cheeks in A New Hope.
Yeah, he does not have red cheeks. So. He does not. He's like a lot more gray, you know. Looks a lot more dead, you know. So it's like, I don't know. It's nitpicky stuff. But, okay, so... I got a controversial statement for you guys again.
I'll probably agree with you.
Probably. I don't know if I like this ending. I don't know if I like it.
I think it's great. It ends right where episode 4 begins.
Like, the way it ends. Like, I don't know how to feel about it, really. Because it doesn't feel... I know this is a prologue to A New Hope. But it just... Something doesn't feel complete about this movie. It's like, I don't know. Well, probably because, like I said, the only story
or plot in this film is to get the plans to the Death Star. Okay, then what? Yes, a New Hope comes after this, but what about the characters that we're following with all this movie? They're all dead. So it's like, it still doesn't feel like this movie is complete. You know, they got the plans, now what? You know? And that's why I'm saying, like, I just wish the characters were better developed in this movie. Honestly, they're like two notches up from Suicide Squad to me. Like, the characters in Suicide Squad, they were interesting, colorful, and likable, but there was barely any development with them. This is the same thing here. So it's like, I don't know. It's like, I would be kind of interested in seeing these characters in another movie, but we don't get to see them, so it's kind of frustrating. And then Forrest Whitaker is wasted. He dies in this movie. Like, it just, I don't know. It's just like, I wish they added more to the plot than just, oh, we're getting the plans of the Death Star. Could be something else happening. I don't think this can hold a 2-hour movie. As I said before, just, what else? It just ends with them running away. It's like Hobbit 2 bad. It's like, oh, he's going to, spoilers for Hobbit 2.
Oh.
Oh, sorry, Captain hasn't seen Hobbit 2, but you know the ending with Smaug, and you know what I'm talking about, and then the beginning of Hobbit 3, you know. Anyway, if you guys have seen it, that's all we're going to say. But it's literally like that. So it's like, it just really frustrated me, and it frustrated even more because the most interesting part of this movie is the last 45 minutes, and I wasted an hour of my time of people going from planet to planet with no rhyme or reason, except, oh, we're getting ready, get ready. 2 hours later. Get ready, we're gonna do it. Oh, there's Vader. So I don't know. That's how I feel about it. At least with Darth Maul and Solo, there wasn't really an expectation for Maul to do anything in the movie, so when the surprise happens, it's like, oh yeah, that's cool. But, and the characters in Solo are more interesting. But I think that's all I got. Anyone else got anything to add?
I do agree with you on the ending. It does feel a little bit, I don't want to say out of place, because that's not like the correct term to use, but that's what I'm going to use because I can't really think of any other way of saying it.
Mm-hmm.
I think either personally for me, it was either one of two reasons. It was either A, yes, the characters weren't really as much throughout this film, which would have helped out a lot,
mm-hmm.
or B, I wasn't thrilled by the music.
Yeah.
Because once, even like when the theme was going around Leia when she says hope, and the ship goes into hyperspace, and then we go straight to the credits, everything else, credits, there was just basically nothing.
Yeah.
Like, I didn't feel like a hype ending leading into 4.
And I bet some people would disagree and be like, oh, see, Leia, and she said hope, and we know what hope means, and yeah, oh my gosh.
Yeah, it all ties in.
It all ties together, man.
But yeah, I do see where you're going with that.
Like, it literally felt like that was where the reshoot started. So, I don't know why Gareth Edwards was taking off this project 90% into this movie. I don't know what was up with the last 45 minutes or so that they had to reshoot stuff.
Wait, what do you mean he was taking off the project?
Yeah, he was taking off the project when he 90% done with it. I think they just mainly had reshot the ending, but I don't know why.
So who finished it up then? Why would they have him not do it?
That's a good question. I don't even know. I think it was just Lucasfilm and everyone else.
That's weird.
That is weird. Because I did notice in the trailers that there were some shots in the trailer that wasn't in the movie. Like, Forrest Whitaker had a bald head, and in this movie he has a full head of hair.
Except for one brief moment at the beginning when he has a bald head before the jump.
Right.
Yeah, that was his bald head moment.
Yeah, though it was a different scene in the trailers, though. And then there was a shot with Jin and everyone running on the beach and the AT-AT shooting at them. That's not in the movie. So, like, what happened? I don't know, but I literally felt like around the time when Vader started showing up, that's when the reshoots were happening, because it felt different from the rest of the film. Like, when all that stuff was happening, I was like, this felt totally different from the rest of the film. So I was like, I don't know.
But yeah, that's all I got for Rogue One. Overall, it's all right. It's decent. I appreciate that they were going in a different direction with Star Wars, bringing more of the war aspects to this film. And there were some awesome Darth Vader scenes, and the visuals are A+, are just incredible. But for me, just the pacing was not good. It was very slow in the beginning. The fan service felt unnecessary in places. The characters were not very well developed outside of 2.5 characters in here. There are very important characters to the Star Wars lore that were wasted in this film. The score was not that memorable to me. It doesn't have to be the best thing ever, but at least I remember a theme from each movie, and I don't remember anything from this film except for that horrible Jin theme. That's gonna haunt my nightmares every day. So as far as, you know, being part of this saga, I will watch this again, but I have to be in a certain mindset to watch this. Like, it's not something I could watch over and over again like I do with The Force Awakens or the original trilogy. Even Revenge of the Sith, I will revisit more than this. So it's like, overall, I have to give Rogue One, an expendable Star Wars story, a C+. Yeah, it was not great. It was not horrible, but it was just fine. Oh my god, it is raining really hard outside.
Yeah, which sucks because we have to take the dog out.
Oh, okay, yeah, I can see dark clouds outside my windows. Oh, that just says everything.
We live in Michigan.
Towards you guys.
Yeah. We live in Michigan, by the way.
Yeah, we had rain weather for like 2 months.
Yeah. Anyway, Crimson.
I give it a B minus.
B minus.
Because while I do still really like it, I understand. You know what? I changed my mind. I'll give it a C+, actually.
Oh.
Sorry, I'll give it a C+. Because there are problems with it that I guess I didn't want to think about until you started talking about it. And then I was like, yeah, okay, whatever. There we go. So, there are problems with it. I still do like it, but now I don't think it's the best. After listening to everybody's opinions, so I give it a C+.
What? Opinions change? Blasphemy! Anyway, Captain Eagle.
Do I have a pick first?
You
want me to go?
Yeah, go.
Okay. Well, I still really love this movie. I definitely agree that the characters are not developed, and they should have trimmed some things, like that squid in that
room. Oh god, cut that scene out completely!
That is deleted scene.
In that rain planet, they could have just cut that out and just had him die in the hologram. That would have made a lot more sense. And instead, just had it be a little more focused on, like, developing the characters. I personally didn't really mind the pacing, but I understand why you guys did. But I still just really love the different feel of this movie. You know, it's unique, but it also feels true to Star Wars, and I love the expansion on things that they did with this. So I still really enjoy this movie. I think it's great. I still think it's one of the best movies, despite it not having the best characters. So I give it an A.
A.
Evan.
Okay.
Oh.
It's one of my favorite Star Wars movies, yeah.
I'm sure the majority will agree with you, though, because people love this movie. So.
Yeah, that's what's going to bother me.
And that's how we feel about the... Never mind. I'm not going to bring it up again. But,
I know what you're talking about today. Don't you try to hide it from me.
We'll talk about that when we get there. Anyway. Ruby!
Okay, so I'm probably going to give, like, the rating out of all of us. Overall, this is a film with just, for me, it's good. I say it's good enough visuals because while, yes, for a film itself, the visuals are beautiful, the visuals as a Star Wars film do not really correlate well with me. And the the space battle is really cool, and the Darth Vader scenes are really cool. That's all I really have to take away from this film. Everything else bothers me. I don't like the majority of the characters. The movie itself, like the first two acts, are just drab, and there is no John Williams, by the way. That's why the score sucks.
But Michael is a great great composer, though. So
yeah, you want to talk about how bad Rogue One was?
It was just a war. Because he's done great scores before. If he had more time to do this movie, I think it would have been better. But anyway.
Yeah, I didn't really feel for any of the characters. If we had more time with developing the characters, I felt like there would have been more meaning behind them. And, I don't know. I just have... Every time I go to see this movie... If I ever see this movie again, I'm probably going to have a harder time than I do watching it today. Because it's just... It's hard to get through. It's harder for me to get through this film than it is to get through Solo. I'm afraid of saying this rating.
It is your opinion.
I'm giving it a 38%.
Holy crap!
I really did not enjoy this film coming back to it. I'm sorry.
Oh my god!
That's rare for me. Keep in mind, I love Star Wars. Star Wars is like the one... If I could take away like one franchise that I would watch for the rest of my life, that would for sure be Star Wars. It's not Marvel. It's not DC. Not like I would say DC. But it's not DC. It's not like Pixar or anything. It's always been Star Wars. And for me to say that I would never go back to see a Star Wars movie again is really rare for me. And one is.
Wow. Okay. Sure, you're gonna have some lovers in the comments. Rogue One's amazing. Why'd you give it a 30-something%?
That's how we feel about
The
Last Jedi.
Patiently.
So this is your least favorite Star Wars movie?
We'll get to that later.
There's something worse than this?
I don't know yet. We have like months away until we get to our ranking video. Like my opinions could change.
Oh my gosh.
But for now, my opinions on these films are staying the way they are.
But anyway, that's our opinions on Rogue One. What did you think about the film? Try not to be too hostile in the comments. Did you guys love it? Did you guys hate it? Did you guys think it was okay? Pick a team, comment below, let us know. So, we got through all the prequels. We got through all the anthology films so far.
We're getting to the goods.
Yes, we're getting to the stuff that people actually want to talk about. We're going to talk about the original trilogy now, and the next film we will be talking about is Star Wars Episode 4, A New Hope. So tune in for that.
Woo!
Yes, can't wait to talk about it. I've actually been waiting to talk about this movie, finally. But anyway, yes. If you guys enjoyed the video, don't forget to leave a like, comment your thoughts, and please subscribe to the channel. If you guys enjoy what I do, you enjoy these videos, please subscribe to the channel to be updated on future videos I'll be doing. Thank you as always for watching. And remember, you are one with the Force, and the Force is with you.
Shut up! Rogue One sucks. Bye, guys.
That's a great line, though. Anyway, see you guys later.
See you next time.
May the Force be with you.
Oh, yeah.
Ha ha.